Thank you so much, Paul. And I thanks to all the StuCamp team. You all have been wonderful and awesome to work with. And it's crazy to see the textbook come to life, but it's here. So I'm going to share my screen and we're going to talk about today's topic. Oops. So media relations during a crisis. Some of these tips, or basically all of these tips, can be used not only during a crisis, but anytime you do an interview with members of the media. And so I wanted to emphasize that. So I'm going to teach you all these tricks and tips. These are things that I have not been able to find in any kind of textbook that deals with public relations or crisis communication. This is something that I learned in industry when I worked in public relations. And so I just think it's really important knowledge for students to have. So hopefully you will agree and you can put some of these things to work in your classroom. So here's our learning objectives for today. First of all, we are going to, and I'm going to introduce some concepts, or what I'm talking about is actually information from the new textbook that Paul went over with you all. We're going to learn to develop key messages for use during a media interview, develop supporting facts for those key messages, effectively use what are called bridging phrases. And I'm going to show you all a couple of video examples of that in use, actually practiced in the real world. Effectively answer reporters' difficult questions, and then prepare for a media interview specifically following negative news or a crisis situation. So here's something that it takes people, especially if they are in a leadership role sometimes, whether it's a CEO, a vice president, your boss, you cannot control the media. I know there are presidents of universities or companies, CEOs, that they tell the PR person, make it go away, just make it go away. Well, you can't just make it go away. You cannot control the media. You can only control your reaction or your response to the media. So that's something that's lesson number one. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that as we go through. So just remember, you can't control the media. You can only control your reaction or response to them. So this is kind of media relations 101. If you don't talk to the media, that doesn't mean the story will go away. A lot of times, I think, again, leaders who aren't savvy in how the media works, public relations, et cetera, they feel like, oh yeah, if I just don't talk to them, if I don't return their call, if I don't give them a quote, it'll just go away. If I say no comment, that'll be the end of it. The media can and will do stories without you. They will find someone else to comment on that story. And that information probably isn't going to be very positive. So when that happens, when you do not become a part of the story or the narrative, then you lose control of it. And you don't want that to happen. You want to be in control of your message going out to the media or through the media to your stakeholders and audience. And if done correctly, this allows you to control the message that you want to get out. Now, I know that it's scary. Sometimes people are like, oh, dealing with the media. But if you take these techniques, if you teach your students these techniques, then they will feel more confident and they will have those skills so that they can engage with a reporter and get their side represented and get their side of the story out. So you want to tell your story. You don't want someone else telling it. Because again, bad things can happen. So staying on message. So I heard this, I cannot remember. I've Googled it. I've tried to figure out where this came. I mean, I know where I heard it. I heard it in a training that I did when I worked in public relations, but I was trying to find it. Did this come from someone, you know, and I couldn't find it, but, it's the answer that counts, not the question. And that's something that you have to remember when you are engaged in a media interview. Now, that doesn't mean that you totally don't answer anything they're talking about. You don't want to sound like a silly person. But just remember, if a reporter asks you a tough question or something that you can't talk about or don't really want to talk about, there's ways around that where you still give the reporter something so that they can do their story, but you also provide your organization you're representing to be represented in the best possible way. So when you're staying on message, it begins with, what do you want people to know? What is the main thing you want to get across? Again, this can apply in any type of media interview, but especially during a crisis, you want to prepare this way. What are the key things that you want to get across? So you think about those. Don't get derailed by reporters' questions. As I said, remember, it's the answer that counts, not the question. And then develop some key messages and use them so that you can stay on message whenever you're engaged in a media interview. One caveat I want to say here, I know that some people probably think, oh, the news media is dying, traditional mainstream media. Not as many people watch. It's scattered across more platforms, obviously. But you see things that happen on traditional media that blow up on social media, or perhaps something on social media then gets, you know, reported and becomes bigger because of mainstream media. So this across platforms, it still has a place and it's still important when you're dealing with the media. So I wanted to mention that as well. So what are key messages? So key messages, you want to develop at least 3 or 4 key messages that you can keep coming back to during your interview. They do not need to be the exact same messages, right? You want to vary them, but it's a way for you to present for your organization or whoever you're representing to present your side of the story. Now with these key messages, you want to have some supporting facts to back those up. And supporting facts are things like examples, anecdotes, statistics, stories, things that support those key messages. And we're gonna see why that's important here in just a second. This is actually from my textbook. This is a graphic and I gave you an example here. So here's a key message having to do with COVID at a university. So you see the key message there. It says there is nothing more important than the health and safety of our staff and students at this university. Okay, that's great. That's a nice little thing to say. However, how are you going to support that? Because reporters will want to know. They're not just going to take that at face value. So you better have some actual facts to back it up. So here's one. Daily random COVID-19 testing of staff and students. Masks must be worn while inside all buildings. 5 free on-campus COVID-19 vaccine clinics. So when the media comes calling and says, hey, we hear there's been an outbreak, or we've got information that your university isn't really taking care of people when it comes to their health and safety in COVID, then you have a response for them. And of course, all of these things must be factual in order to use them as supporting facts. You would never want to just make things up. So another caveat there as well. So here are some key message examples. Things like, our company firmly believes in diversity. There's nothing more important than the health and safety of our employees. Our organization is proud that we volunteer 1,000 hours every year. Our organization is fully committed to diversifying our workforce. The health is a priority for our company, or the health and safety of our employees is a priority for our company. So that gives you some ideas of how to start those key messages that you would want to use in your media interview. So I talked about the importance of supporting facts. So just to give you all an example here, I have scripted here, and this is actually from the textbook as well, because I want to spell it out really succinctly, simply for students to understand. So you have a reporter who says, can you tell us what happened at your manufacturing facility? And the spokesperson has a nice little response here where they have a key message. So we are still collecting details on exactly what happened. What I can tell you is that, here's that key message, there is nothing more important than employee safety at our company. And the reporter would then say, well, if that's the case, then why did this accident happen? So let's look at one with supporting facts. So here you have the reporter, can you tell us what happened at your manufacturing facility? We have the spokesperson saying, we're still collecting details on exactly what happened. What I can tell you, which is a bridging phrase, which we're gonna cover here in a minute, is that there is nothing more important than employee safety at our company. Again, there is that key message. But then the spokesperson has supporting facts. That's why we do extensive safety training for employees, regular safety inspections of our equipment. And then they offer a solution that we will find out what happened in this instance and make any corrections if needed. So basically the spokesperson has come out assertively and let them know what they're doing. That way you're not on a defense when you just have a key message and no supporting facts to back it up, and you have to have the reporter ask you another question that puts you on the defense. Just get it all out there. And again, this is a perfect example of how to get your message across when you're engaged in a media interview. So let's talk about bridging real quick. Bridging, I sometimes call it pivoting. To me, that makes sense. But you aren't doing an entire pivot away from the reporter's question. You're just getting to the answer in a different way. So bridging helps you link those key messages to those supporting facts. Some examples of those bridging phrases: what I'd like to stress, in fact, what's important is, things like, for example, what we're focusing on, what I can say, what I will say, what I will tell you, what people should know. The list goes on and on, but these are bridging phrases that helps you get back on track, whatever the question that the reporter asks you. Again, this takes practice, and you don't want, I saw a video one time, I think this gentleman was running for, it was politics. He was running for some position in South Carolina, I believe, and he went on one of the cable shows, and he just kept repeating the exact same phrase over and over and over to every question. That's not how you do it. That's not what you want to do. So just keep that in mind. And then, so here's a bridging example. Here's a reporter. We've heard rumors that this accident could be the result of employee sabotage. What do you have to say about that? Spokesperson, I can't speak to that because the investigation is incomplete. But what I can tell you, and there's that bridge, is that there's nothing more important than employee safety at our company. That's why we do extensive safety training for employees and regular safety inspections of our equipment. So there you have your supporting facts, along with, you see the bridge there, and the key messages. And then finally, putting it all together, and then I'm going to show you all a couple of quick examples, video examples. So putting it all together, we have the reporter. This is a situation where students were acting inappropriately at a high school. So the reporter comes, why are students at your school so racially insensitive? Again, a loaded question. Reporters love loaded questions. The spokesperson, there is no place for that kind of behavior at our school. There's your key message. In fact, there's a bridge. Since this incident occurred, we have brought in professionals to educate our students on racism and prejudice. We also identified the students responsible for the racial slurs and punished them. There's your supporting facts. From here on out, we will be making race relations a priority at Cooper High School. So that's putting it all together, what it looks like. And so let me show you, I can pull up. I have some examples that I've used in my classes of where you will see this in action. Representative, unfortunately, has to do with politics. I apologize. But Representative Aguilar, I believe he's from California. He does a really good job. I want you all to listen to him being interviewed and see what you think as far as how he's putting to use the strategies that we just talked about. And you know what? I think I have to go back and make sure that I have the sound clicked. There we go. Okay.
Alternate, the fake electors, many of them have been subpoenaed. Have any of them scheduled or participated in interviews with the committee yet or signaled a willingness to do so? I know at least a couple have signaled a willingness, but have any of those happened yet?
I can't talk about the schedule and who's kind of come in before us and who's come in. But what I can tell you is there are a lot of individuals who have come before us, 475 total witness interviews. Some people voluntarily, some people quietly, and some people obviously through subpoenas. But we continue to gather that information. And I would say with this group, that is no different.
Two very senior aides to the former vice president have been in this week, Mr. Jacobs and Mr. Short. Can you characterize the cooperation as helpful, fulsome, incomplete? I mean, can you tell us if they have been cooperative witnesses?
I've seen the public reporting. I'm so sorry. I can't talk about specific folks who come in before us and what they tell us. But what I can say generally is every interview that we've had, even those of the past, you know, few days and few weeks, have led to more information that we wanted to know. So all of these are helpful in piecing these together in that connective tissue that we know needs to be addressed between these lines of inquiry that we have, because there are multiple things that we are doing and multiple things we are seeking here, not just the timeline and not just the fraudulent electors. There's a lot there. And so we're gathering that information, and all of these interviews have been helpful to clarify or corroborate other things that we know or have heard.
And I respect that you can't speak about those things. We have to try. I have a question about another piece of the ex-president's remarks when he dangled pardons in front of everyone who participated in the insurrection. Have you been able to detect any change in posture as it pertains to anyone's testimony or document production since that offer was made to the 1-6 subjects and targets and defendants by Donald Trump?
Well, we've issued public subpoenas for individuals who were engaged, obviously, in the insurrection on January 6th. I can't talk about what we've heard and what we've gathered, but what I can tell you is that the tweet he posed, or the threat and offer, basically, of a pardon, is deeply dangerous. I think it crossed the line. I think there are significant problems with it, but what he did was exactly what he's done consistently, which is say the quiet part out loud. Just like he told the world that Vice President Pence was supposed to overturn the election this last weekend, he wanted to put this out there related to pardons to help to presumably ice our efforts and investigations. We can't let that happen, and so we'll continue to proceed swiftly.
Alternate, the fake elector.
Okay, so what did you all, anyone wants to put in the chat, a bridging phrase that Representative Aguilar used during that interview? And yes, it is a very timely example. Thank you. Did anyone notice what he relied on? He relied on the same one quite a bit, which was what I can tell you. So obviously she was trying to make news to get information out of him. And he did not take the bait, right? He gave her something. He continued with the interview. However, he did not give her headlines, which is a lot of times what reporters are trying to do. Again, they are not trying to, they're not evil people. That's one thing that I want to emphasize is reporters, there are bad reporters, but there's bad bankers, there's bad doctors, there's bad everything. And so they're just trying to do their job. They're trying to make news, but you have to protect yourself, protect your company, and protect your reputation with all of this. So that's one thing that I wanted to emphasize. And I'm trying to get back to okay, here we go. I have one other example that I want to show you all. This is actually from a government official, the CIA, where the CIA director is being interviewed on 60 Minutes concerning Havana syndrome, which is this mysterious illness that some government officials have been hit with, and they're still trying to figure it all out. So I'm gonna make sure that you all can hear this. Show you. Okay.
In my first week as director, I began what had become dozens and dozens of meetings with affected officers and family members. And I found their stories to be powerful and compelling and sometimes heartbreaking.
Bill Burns had heard those stories from CIA officers who reported injuries since 2016. But this past fall, while on an official visit to India, a member of his staff was stricken in their hotel. Later, Burns personally escorted that staff member to medical evaluations.
It seems that the Delhi incident might have been intended to send you a message.
I don't know, and as I said, I can't comment on individual cases here as well. All I can tell you is that each story I've heard, each officer I've met with who's been affected by this, just redoubles my commitment and my determination on this issue. I have enormous faith in our officers.
Bill Burns served five presidents at the State Department, rising to the highest rank in the Foreign Service. He took over CIA for President Biden last spring.
Early on, I tripled the number of full-time medical personnel working on this issue. We streamlined access to Walter Reed, established new partnerships with other world-class medical providers, increased the number of case managers, and we're also making progress on the investigative side as well.
Progress on the investigative side.
Okay, so with that one, can anyone tell me in the chat where you saw the CIA director using some of the techniques that we talked about before? Anyone? Oh, Scott Pelley, that's true. I can't comment on individual cases. Exactly. And he used some supporting facts at the very end. So where he talked about all the things that he had been doing to take care of or to address the situation. And again, he used that, what I can tell you. So reporters, again, they're trying to do their job, give them something. If you say no comment, it not only makes you look guilty, but it also makes it more difficult for reporters to do their job. Let me get back here and... So let's continue. I have some more things to share. So after you deal with or you prepare for your interview by coming up with these key messages and these supporting facts, then what you need to think about is the type of questions that a reporter will ask you. And there are some that they really like to rely on. Reporters like to ask difficult questions because, again, they're trying to get a story. So they want to know, why is it that people, your employees are getting ill overseas? Are we being targeted? I understand XYZ. Is this true? What do you think about? What are you doing about? They also want to know who's responsible for. That's a big one. So those are the kinds of questions that you can or need to be prepared for when you're preparing for an interview. Another thing I'll say is that I have students a lot of times who are like, oh, that seems like cheating. It's not cheating, because I guarantee you that the reporter is going to rehearse the questions they're going to ask you and they're going to be prepared. So you as a spokesperson need to be prepared as well and rehearse and think through these things before engaging in an interview. So one specific question that they really like a lot is the hypothetical question, which this involves a what if situation. It asks the spokesperson to comment on something that hasn't happened yet. So here are some examples. What if you don't win another game this season? Will you run for president of the United States in 2024? What if the Sports Illustrated story about the university's football program is true? What if you lose the primary election? Why do you all think that reporters like to use hypothetical questions? Anyone have any guesses on why they would like these types of questions? Something that hasn't happened yet, you can say so in the chat. You can guess, don't be shy. Let's say that you did say, no, I'm not running for president in 2024. And then a year later you announce so that they can use it in the future. Yes, thank you, Lakeisha. So that they can come back to you and say, there's conflict here. And of course, conflict drives news coverage. So they can come back and say, but you said in this interview that you wouldn't run. They love that conflict. And so that's one reason they're trying to make news too. So just, you want to be careful with those hypothetical questions. And here's how you can answer some of those hypothetical questions, how to deal with them. Suggested answers, things like, I cannot speak on something that hasn't happened yet. Just basically say, I can't answer a hypothetical question, but what I can tell you, and then you would go into what you want to get across to your stakeholders, the audience. I'm not going to speculate on whatever the situation is, or I can't speak to something that may or may not happen. And you will see skilled interviewers or interviewees use this technique. It also happens in sports a lot too. I think on the other slide, I had something about what if you don't win another game this season? And you will hear coaches who have been media trained, sometimes they'll say, hey, look, we're taking this game by game, even players. We're taking this one game at a time. That's what we're focusing on. They won't take that bait and say, you know, well, if we don't win another game, then I may get fired or, you know, something like that. You don't want to make headlines. That's one thing you're trying to avoid when you are engaging in some type of media interview. Here's some more advice. Never, ever comment on a quote by another. So reporters may ask you to comment on a quote or action by another person. If they do, don't do it. And that's because the reporter, again, is trying to create some type of conflict to drive news coverage. Instead, say, I have no knowledge and therefore I can't provide an opinion or something similar. Simply state that you're not the best person to comment on what someone else said, on their situation. You don't really have in-depth knowledge of their experience, their situation, et cetera. Because again, they're going to try to set up conflict. I don't know if you all to go back to the January 6th hearings, but there was some conflict between members saying about whether they were going to try to do a turnover, a criminal referral to the Department of Justice. One member of the committee said they were, another one said they weren't, and all of a sudden, ooh, we've got conflict. So that became a headline and drove some news coverage for a while. And it may still, we'll see. Another tricky technique that reporters like to use, it's called the unacceptable alternative question. So this is one in which a reporter asks a question while also supplying two negative alternatives as part of the question. So here we have an example, why are student athletes failing in school? Is it because coaches are not emphasizing the importance of academics, or is it because no one is checking up on the athlete's academic progress? So they ask the question, they give two solutions, and they're hoping that you are not savvy enough or trained, media trained, to where you will respond that maybe you'll pick one of those. And even worse, you'll repeat the negative part of it. That's another thing. I don't have it in this presentation, but you never want to repeat the reporter's question in your answer, because a lot of times it's negative and you don't want those negative words coming out of your mouth. So instead of saying, well, we are emphasizing the importance of the academics by XYZ, instead, you would say something like, there's nothing more important than our athletes' academics, and here's what we're doing, okay? You definitely wouldn't want to answer by saying, well, we are checking up on athletes' academic progress, because that puts you on the defensive, and it just looks bad for your organization. So here's how you would answer. Are universities committed to student athlete success? For example, we offer tutoring services to all student athletes and require they check in daily with their academic advisor. So this is a perfect example of when the answer counts, not the question. You're still answering the question, but it's more important what you want to get across. And again, you still give them an answer to their question. You just aren't tricked into saying something that you will regret later. So some additional tips, never ever say no comment, because it makes you look guilty, but it also is difficult for the reporter to do their story. If you say no comment on something, they'll find someone else to comment. Maybe your opposition, someone who doesn't like you, man on the street that will say something outrageous that has no knowledge of even what's going on. So again, don't say no comment. If you can't talk about something, explain why. So for example, we can't discuss a pending legal case. We can't discuss something that involves an employee's personal medical records or their personnel issues. If in fact you cannot talk about it. Now don't make something up and say you can't talk about it when really legally you can, or according to your company you can, because the reporters will sniff that out and come back and confront you on that. It's okay to say, I don't know. I think this is something that people think too when they're being interviewed, interviewees, that they have to know all the answers, and they don't. But what you do want to do is offer to find the information for the reporter or refer them to someone who does know that information. So again, you get more flies with honey than vinegar. So you want to help the reporter any way that you can. I know that a lot of times people's initial response is to, or their instinct is to, like, oh, I don't want to see a reporter. I don't want to talk to a reporter. But if you develop relationships with them and work with them in a professional manner and provide information to them, then they're going to come back to you and they're going to appreciate you and give you maybe the benefit of the doubt if something ever happens negative regarding your organization. So that is really quick, but that's what I wanted to teach you all today, to teach your students, to use your on your own if you'd like. But it, again, it's about staying on message, preparing for those media interviews. One thing I will mention is that the simulation has an opportunity for students to do this. So they get to record a statement that they put together to the media after a crisis occurs, but they also get to do a back and forth answering reporters' questions. So that's something that I'm really excited about because I don't see that. I don't see students getting that experience when they are in college. And I think it's something that they really need. They need to know how to prepare spokespeople that they work with, but also if they are called upon to be a spokesperson themselves. So I also provided a handout that I hope Paul or someone can share with you all, or it's available to download somewhere. But if you all would like to take that, you can do that. That can easily be converted to an assignment. All you would need to do is give them a scenario to work with and then have them come up with three or four key messages, some supporting facts. Obviously, they would you know, have to fib about the supporting facts unless they have actual internal knowledge of the company, organization, situation. But yeah, so you can just use that and turn that into an assignment very easily. So that is all I have. Thank you all for listening and for being here today. And I'm happy to answer questions. I'm happy to connect with anyone. You can find me on LinkedIn and yeah.
Thank you, Shelley. That was awesome. I feel like I could hit the media right now and know exactly what to say. Go ahead. If you have a question, and put it in the chat, and we'll ask Shelley while she's here with us. I will make sure that everyone in this group, that we get that assignment emailed out so that they can have access to that. Shelley, let's see, Kyle said, my favorite session so far. This is a topic students always want to know more about.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. And I don't know. It's so weird. Like I said, I haven't seen it in textbooks. Now I have seen it in like an industry type book, but not in textbooks. We don't teach it. It doesn't seem in college. And I just, yeah, we need to teach our students this. So
yeah, definitely.
Well, but thank you, Jerry Lynn.
Maybe while we have a little time here, you talked a little bit about the simulation and some of the things, some of the benefits and features in that, mm-hmm. like meeting with a reporter. Mm-hmm. Would you have anything you'd like to say about additionally about the simulation and some of the fun activities or learning experiences that students will experience with it?
Sure. So with the simulation, there are the first four rounds deal with a reputational crisis. So in the text, in the course where students learn the difference between a reputational crisis and an operational crisis, and there's a big difference. And I think most of what we see these days are reputational crises, right? Something happens on Twitter, it's not going to shut the whole company down. But if you have enough of those, you know, it really dings your reputation and can impact you operationally. But so the first four rounds focus on reputational crises, and students get to practice these preemptive pre-crisis communication strategies, which again, that's something else that I have not seen in other crisis communication textbooks. And that's another reason why I wanted to write the book. But there are strategies that you can use, communication strategies. It's important how and what you communicate to your stakeholders before a crisis ever occurs. Now, we normally, you know, focus on planning, you know, putting together a crisis plan, maybe do some media training, but there are also things that you can do constantly communicating with your stakeholders to insulate them so that when a crisis occurs, that their attitudes are still on your side of your company. They still support you. And so that deals with the first four rounds, which are those reputational crises. There's different ones. And then the rounds 5 through 8 deal with an operational crisis, which is really fun for students to deal with. And they keep getting new information. There's like, it's like in real time. So something happens, then there's new information about it. Now what are you going to do? There's new information. Now what are you going to do? And they get to put together everything from like a news release to social media post. They get to do a video that is recorded, that they record themselves, that is peer reviewed by their peers or graded by their peers. And that's going to be something that they would like upload to social media, a statement about the crisis situation at that point. And then also, as I said, they get to do this back and forth with a reporter and answering those difficult questions. And they get to practice that, because I know we're lucky enough that we have a TV studio where I teach, but I know that not everyone has that situation, or maybe you don't have, you know, broadcasting equipment or broadcasting facility. But this is a nice option, I think, for students to really practice those skills.
Thanks, Shelley. It sounds amazing.